Hi, welcome again. More American Cooking. This time, New Orleans, a fascinating city. I think New Orleans is probably the best restaurant city in America. All right, so you're asking, so I'll tell you. I also love New York, San Francisco, Chicago, Seattle, and Boston. Please don't, why do I do these things? Please don't write and tell me. These are my favorites, and I love them. But I really love New Orleans more than anything else. Fabulous city. It was founded in 1682 by La Salle, the explorer, and in 1722, immigrants began coming in from all over Europe, but most of them were French. They brought in some interesting people. For instance, there was a group of women, 50 girls from houses of correction, whatever that means, in Paris, and they were the only girls in town around 1722. By 1753, King Louis XV of France, after whom Louisiana was named, was very, very bored with the territory, thought it was too much trouble, so he, get this, he gave the whole place, the whole territory, to Spain, just gave it. And then the Spanish came. So we had another very interesting influence. And along with the Spanish came Acadians from France. And some of them came from French Nova Scotia. They were persecuted there, and they went into the bayous and the back rivers of New Orleans, and their name, Acadian, was cut down to Cajuns, a name that they still bear, and they bear it very, very proudly. By the middle 1700s, they had settled throughout the bayous of Louisiana, around New Orleans, and began a very interesting culture. You can go there and meet them and eat with them, and the most wonderful sausages, fabulous food. Cajuns, Acadians, originally from France and French Nova Scotia. Now, the Spanish had a very open immigration policy, so people came in from all over the place, just all over. 1790, the slave uprisings in Santo Domingo, what we now call Haiti, caused a lot of people to come into New Orleans too. So then we have the Haitian influence, and with them came voodoo. So you see, the more you study New Orleans, the more complex the soup, the cooking becomes. Fabulous place. Napoleon then decided, when he was emperor, decided that he wanted Louisiana back from the French, from the Spanish rather, so he took it. Just took it, claimed it his again. What he really wanted to do was to raise some money, and he sold it to the United States for, let's see, I've got the amount here. He needed the money, here it is, he needed the money, so in 1803, the great Louisiana Purchase took place, $11.25 million, and the cancellation of a $3,075,000 credit debt that we owed, or he owed to us, so he wiped everything out, and 1812, Louisiana became the 18th state. It's a wonderful place, and New Orleans is, for me, the most colorful place in the state. It is French, it is Haitian, it is Cajun, it is Creole. Oh, Creole is the name of the city dwellers who came, the city livers who came in from Europe, and their actual name was Creole, and it was shortened to Creole. So the difference in terms of food between Cajun and Creole is probably the same difference that you'll find in France between French country cooking, the Cajuns, the bayou people, and Creole, which is the city people, a little more involved and a little more on a grand cuisine scale. Got all that? All right, let's do some cooking. It's a wonderful place. If you haven't ever been there, for heaven's sakes, you must go. First of all, one of the most famous dishes in all of Louisiana is jambalaya. Now, I have offered jambalaya in a couple of my cookbooks already. This is another recipe, another variation. You can go on and on and on with jambalaya. Jambalaya is simply rice cooked with a lot of leftovers. You see, you couldn't afford to waste things in the old days. Now we waste everything, but you don't waste it. All right, here we go. Let me get us started here. Yes, kettle's about hot. So into my kettle, I'm going to put about 3 tablespoons of peanut oil, and we'll just start throwing things in. We're going to saute now the following items in my kettle. I have some yellow onions. I want one large yellow onion. There we go. And we want to add to that 2 green peppers. Just chopped up in big chunks. You see, 1, 2. Is that about 2 green peppers? I think so. And we're going to add, I'm going to change burners here. This isn't hot enough yet. So I'll just move it over. On my range, I have a center burner that's very, very hot. And the other burners are not quite as hot, so we'll We'll change things around here and get some action. There. We're sauteing the vegetables, not just to make them soft and soggy, but to improve the flavor. That's very important in good Cajun or Creole cooking. All right, then we need about 3 cloves of garlic, and I've already chopped my garlic up. I ran it through my medium-sized food processor. Oh, that's about that. That's enough. 3 cloves is plenty. And some celery, about 4 ribs of celery. How do you measure 4 ribs of celery? Well, I've got so much stuff I want to do for you. I'm just chopping it all up. That's 4 ribs. All right, that's 4 ribs. There we are. Have to be really accurate. And some green onions, about 6 green onions. There we go. Oh, 6 of them. All right, now saute this until it's the onions are a little bit limp. Shouldn't just take a few minutes, you see. I'm not going to take all of that time, of course, but you understand, you want to saute this now in your kettle. This is a 12-quart stock pot. I think this is one of the most useful things you could possibly have in your kitchen. A 12-quart stock pot. Mine is aluminum. Don't worry about that. Just don't store food in aluminum, and you'll have no difficulty. Keep it clean. It's the most helpful thing you can have in your kitchen. Absolutely love it. All right. Now, at the end of that time, end of the sauteing time, I'm going to add 1 can of tomatoes. And these want to squish up. It's 28 ounces, you see. And you squish them up by just that's right. There they go. You'd probably want your grade school kid to do this part because he'll laugh and holler and get tomato juice all over the place. All right, put in 1 28-ounce can of tomatoes. And then I have a mess here. I have 3.5 cups of chicken broth. And this will begin to cook up. 3.5 cups of chicken broth. So far we have simply vegetables. All right, then we sauteed, added the tomato. Is tomato a fruit or a vegetable? I don't know. Are we still arguing about that? I don't know the answer. And 3.5 cups of broth, chicken broth. Bring that to a simmer. Cook that for a while. About an hour. We want everything to begin to blend. And then we add 1/2 pound of sausage. And what I've done, these are smoky hot sausages or something like that, you see. Just throw them in. Brown them ahead of time, you see. There we are. Brown them ahead of time. There we go. That's about 1/2 pound. And add that to your pot. Now, I want to add 1 cup of ham. And the ham has already been cooked. It's a good smoked ham. But not pan-fried. I've just sliced it up, you see. Good ham. And 2 tablespoons of parsley. Parsley's a wonderful, wonderful herb, not a spice. Remember, the difference between an herb and a spice is that spices are generally seeds, and herbs are generally leaves. Got that? Let that cook again for a while. We're going to add some other seasoning now. Just keep it boiling. All right, where's the Tabasco? Here it is. Here, now we're into New Orleans cooking. We need Tabasco and Worcestershire and thyme. Those three are simply basic to good cooking in Louisiana. I have, I hate these little tops. I'm sorry, but you people at Lee and Perrins make the very best Worcestershire sauce in the world, but that little top drives me crazy because I want 1/4 cup. You heard me. 1/4 cup of Worcestershire. Got that? And then I want some Tabasco. I want about 2 teaspoons. Look at it go. Look at it go. When you're in Louisiana, New Orleans, they'll put this little bottle, this very size, is on every single table for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. This one. They even have little silver holders to keep it on the table. That's how important this sauce is. And it's made just outside of New Orleans. In Iberia? Is that the name of the place? It's a wonderful island, yes. New Iberia, Louisiana. It takes a year to make this stuff. Wonderful. I just love it. And the other thing I told you about was thyme. I want about 3 teaspoons. 1, 2, 3. Thyme in the kettle. And stir that up and let that simmer for about 20 minutes more with the seasonings. And at the end of the 20 minutes, got that? The end of the 20 minutes, we're going to add 2 cups of rice, and I'm using converted rice. Converted rice it doesn't goo up so much. 2 cups. There you go. Put the lid on that. There. Don't ask for the recipe again. I don't have time to even repeat it. But it is in the cookbook. It is in the American cookbook. So you'll be all right. Now, put the lid on that and cook this for about 25 minutes. The rice will absorb the moisture. Well, let me show you what you have. Get this one off the stove here. Okay. And here's one that's finished. This stuff is just wonderful. I just love it. I need a big serving pot here. Here it is. Oh, tell you what. Guess what? You know what I did? Look at, see this big tray of spare ribs? I have a couple pounds of spare ribs that I have browned in the oven. That should have gone in the pot too at the very beginning. So add that to the top of your recipe. Put the spare ribs in. So we have three kinds of meat in our jambalaya. Spare ribs, hot smoky link sausage, or even Polish sausage we do, and ham. Good ham, right? Glad I saw them sitting back there. Oh, well. Throw them in the pot at the very beginning and cook them along with the wonderful dish called jambalaya. You can see some of the spare ribs in here. There we go. Oh, this stuff is great. There's an awfully big spare rib there. But you serve this as a main dish. I would simply serve a little bit of salad on the side, and you're about ready. You don't need much more. Not much more at all. It's a whole meal. It's just, oh, for me, this is New Orleans. You know, there's always a fight going on in New Orleans. A nice fight. But there's always a fight going on among the jambalaya cookers. Every restaurant has their own theory. Everybody has their favorite. Little parsley there for a garnish. But I just love this stuff. All right, jambalaya. Now, the other fight that goes on in Louisiana is over the nature and the background of red beans and rice. In the old days, that was slave food. It was food for really bad times in the slave quarters because you used bad pieces of meat and you had to pickle it. Most of the recipes that I'd seen for red beans and rice had never contained pickled pork. So now I have one. This one, the lady claims, is authentic. Well, my others were authentic, too. Each cookbook has red beans and rice because I love this stuff. So let's make a batch of red beans and rice. But first of all, we're going to make pickled pork, something that's very simple and really great fun. I want, this is stainless kettle now because we're going to use vinegar. Don't use aluminum. You can't put acid in aluminum and let them sit a long time. You see, I told you not to store stuff, right? Excuse me. All right, here we go. I want to put into my kettle the following goodies. I want a half a cup of mustard seed. I shouldn't let you see this spice jar. Don't buy it in spice jars. Please, buy it in the bulk. It's much cheaper that way. And I want a tablespoon. That's half a cup of mustard seed, a tablespoon of celery seed, 2 tablespoons of Tabasco. Now get ready. We're going to add some other things too. So it's all right. 2 tablespoons. Lord, that's half a jar. I have a big, big jar, but I used it up getting ready for you, so I'm down to the little ones. 2 tablespoons of Tabasco. Got that? And then 1 quart of distilled vinegar or regular white vinegar. 1 quart. There we go. And a couple of bay leaves. Let's see. These are not too large. There we go. That should do us. A couple of bay leaves and 1 tablespoon of kosher salt. Now, I'm using kosher because it has no iodine in it. 1 tablespoon of kosher salt, you see? Isn't it wonderfully flaky stuff? I don't want you to eat much salt, but now and then I sprinkle a little of this. It's simply called kosher salt, you see? And it's a great necessity if you run a kosher kitchen. And it's wonderful to sprinkle this on a salad because it doesn't dissolve right away and it's sort of kind of crunchy. Oh, it's good. All right, back to this. 12 peppercorns. Here we go. 12 peppercorns. Oh, so what? That's pretty close. A couple more. I like pepper in mine. And 6 cloves of garlic chopped up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Ah, we're close. And then we're going to boil this. Put this on the burner. Boil it for about 3 minutes. That's all you need. Just bring it to a boil and turn it off. Cool it. Cool the pot so that we won't change the meat. And then we're going to put about 2 pounds of pork butt. And you can either leave it in big pieces like this, or you can chop it up into smaller pieces. Now, I have to let this sit in the refrigerator for 3 days, covered in stainless steel or in glass or porcelain, not aluminum. Aluminum is not for storage. I've made that point clear to you today, haven't I? And then, at the end of the 3 days, I'll show you what we have here. I have a whole pot of this stuff. The meat will change color a bit, you see? And it's pickled pork. Very necessary to good Louisiana cooking. Now, what are we going to do with that? Well, we're going to cook red beans and rice with pickled pork. And here's what we'll do. I have a pound of beans. There we go. I have a pound of red beans that I have soaked overnight and cooked for just a bit, just a few minutes, so that they're ready to go. Now, I want to add to that, just throw it in the pot. Very, very simple. One chopped yellow onion. And then we're going to add one bunch of green onions. Whole bunch, just a good handful, you see, like so. There we are, that'll do us. And then we want to add 7 cloves of garlic. All this garlic? I chopped up 40 cloves of garlic today in my food processor, my little one. By little, I mean medium size. The little bitty one will make mud out of garlic, and your great big one will simply throw it all over the walls of the machine. So I have a medium size one that I really enjoy. Works great. Parsley, half a cup of parsley into the pot. Red beans and rice. Everybody tells me that their recipe is better. And I gather as many as I possibly can, because if you were a little kid being raised in New Orleans, you knew red beans and rice, absolutely. One rib of celery. One rib. You understand, one stalk or whatever you want to call it. Now, here's the weird thing that she does. This is one of my viewers that sent me this one. She puts in half a cup of ketchup, which kind of surprised me. But, oh, boy, is it good. It's also messy. Ketchup is a scream. All right, half a cup. And one green pepper chopped up. There we go. Now, we're going to add some pork to that. See what else we need here. But we have to add our basic flavorings now. We want a tablespoon of Worcestershire. That was a big one. 2 teaspoons of good old Tabasco. You got to have it. 2 teaspoons. That should do enough. And a bay leaf. You know, somebody wrote me a letter a while back saying bay leaves are poison if you leave them in the food. That's simply utter nonsense. It is true that if you leave a bay leaf in the pot, someone might chew on it and think it's a bit strange, but I've never worried about that. I always leave mine in the pot because I think people are fairly intelligent and they will take it out. If you don't like it or if you're worried about someone choking on a bay leaf, take it out. But the bay leaf itself is not poisonous. Absolutely out of the question. I promise you. And we have some thyme coming up here. There we go. How much do I want? Oh, about a teaspoon, huh? Good fat teaspoon of thyme. Now, you're saying, well, he's repeating his flavors. Everything will change. Everything will change. And the dishes will stand on their own. Though thyme, Worcestershire, and Tabasco are very, very common in New Orleans cookery. Oh, I love this stuff. All right, now, I want a pound of sausage. Throw that in the pot. Again, you can use hot smoked links, or you can use smoky Polish sausage, whatever you like. And then, at last, we're going to put in the pork. I'm going to use about a pound of pork, but I want you to rinse this off. This is the pickled pork, but I want you to rinse it, please, because otherwise, it is simply too vinegary. Here's a pound. I'm going to rinse this off, and this stuff will keep in the refrigerator for a good week and a half, 2 weeks. Okay, there we go. Certainly doesn't take long. There we are. Into the pot. Cover all this up. Now, I have enough water to cover so that your beans will cook properly. And that'll probably take a good hour and a half to cook. Somewhere between an hour and a half. And when you're finished, it's time for red beans and rice. Let me serve some for you. It is a classic from New Orleans. A great American city that boasts a tradition of food that's just startlingly wonderful. Let's see, here it is, rice. Okay. Regular white grain rice, first of all, goes on the plate, and then we'll put the red beans on top. I have a batch all cooked for you. Oh, this is good. You can buy this in every restaurant imaginable. Which is my favorite restaurant? Well, I have a dish coming up, and I'll tell you. My favorite restaurant, that's hard to say. I love Nolan's Cookery. That's a good place. Dick and Ella Brennan run the Commander's Palace. I think they're geniuses. That's wonderful. That's out in the Garden District. The Bon Ton is just, I worship that guy. Now, we have some beans here. Oh, red beans and rice. This is down-home cooking. Wonderful stuff. And you serve the beans right over the rice, and you say, isn't that a double starch? Well, in the old days, I suppose it was a necessity, because we have to fill you up on something. And there wasn't an awful lot to eat in those quarters. But now it's a great delicacy and a great luxury, and we eat it because we want to, not because we have to. So here you are. Red beans and rice from New Orleans. This time with pickled pork. So it's different than the two previous recipes that I've given you in the past. Now, let's get a burner going. One more for you. This one was given me by the owner of the wonderful restaurant called the Bon Ton. And he named it Oysters Alvin. And I'll show you what to do. It's very, very quick and very easy and utterly delicious. Though when he described the dish to me, when he told me what he was doing, it sounded strange. I really wasn't prepared for this. It'll sound strange to you too. First of all, we want to deep fry some oysters. Right away you go, oh no! In Seattle, we would never do such a thing. But you do it very, very carefully and very, very quickly. So here is a dozen oysters. You see? Nothing to it. I've pan fried them or deep fried them with a little flour first. Coat them with a little flour, pan fry them for a minute in deep oil, you know, about an inch deep. Oh, half an inch would be plenty. I shouldn't say that. Turn them once unless you want to use a big deep fryer. I don't even own a deep fryer, a big deep fat fryer. I don't even have one. Now, he's using margarine in the frying pan. See, I'm going to get out of the way here. I'm going to heat up my frying pan and saute very quickly a good handful of mushrooms here, sliced mushrooms. There we go. This is all very, very simple, and it's not at all complex. For Oysters Alvin, a dish that he developed and named after the original owner of the Bon Ton. And all of those places go way, 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 way back. The city was founded in 1600-something, and it's not unusual to find a restaurant down there that's 100 years old. Galatoire's, I think, is, what is it, they're on their fourth generation or something? That's a good place, too. There. All right, we have sautéed our mushrooms and a little bit of margarine, quarter of a stick. Margarine is common in New Orleans, rather than butter. Now, on a fourth of a cup of beef stock, let that simmer for just a minute, which is about all we have. And while that's cooking, I want to show you some others. I want to cook that down for a bit, along with the juice of half a lemon. Oh, where did I put my knives? Don't know where they're at. Okay. Juice of one half lemon. So I have in my pan then a little bit of margarine, quarter of a stick, fourth of a cup of beef stock, good handful of mushrooms, and that's pretty much it. We're going to reduce that for a minute or cook it down. It's about 2 minutes, and then we'll put the oysters in there and pop this under a broiler. However, I want to show you a dish called dirty rice. Calm down. It isn't dirt that you put in it. It's chopped up gizzards and liver. Chopped up chicken liver and chicken gizzards, so that it gives the rice a kind of dirty-looking effect. It's just terrific. Really an unusually good dish. Again, it looks kind of like peasant food, but it's not at all. It has a lot of sausage and very good things in it. All right, here we go. I'm going to put my oysters now that I've fried already on top of the sauce. Better turn that off. The sauce is lemon juice, beef stock, remember? And a bit of mushroom and margarine. That's all there is to it. Now, on top of this, you put some salt and pepper. Just a tiny bit. And sprinkle some pepper. And then he puts a bit of paprika on it. There we go. And then he pops these under a broiler. And you have Oysters Alvin. Does that sound strange to you? I'm going to put it under a broiler now. It's really very delicious. All right. And I'll haul out the last one. The other thing that I love in New Orleans cooking and that Americans and the rest of the country rarely eat is eggplant. And you can buy it stuffed, and you can buy it full of shrimp. Wonderful. But here's an eggplant casserole. Ugh. Won't have time for the recipe for this, obviously. But you'll enjoy this. It's in the book. Ouch. There it is. There's an eggplant casserole for you. Again, it's filled with sausage, a little egg, a lot of meat. Oh, it's rich. Awfully rich. A little bit of tomato, and of course, Worcestershire thyme and Tabasco. Remember those three. All right. Come on, oysters. I think you're done, fellows. You're going to have to be. Pop these under the broiler until they're hot again. Out they go. And here, a gift from our friends at the Bon Ton, wonderful place, Oysters Alvin. Okay. We've done it. American cooking is great fun, And I really am convinced that that you'll have a better time in New Orleans than almost any place in the country for eating. I've tried to prove my point today with a jambalaya, which is delicious, red beans and rice, oysters, Alvin, dirty rice, which isn't dirty at all, and an eggplant casserole. We've been celebrating New Orleans. Till I see you again, this is the Frugal Gourmet. I'm glad you came by. I bid you peace. Bye-bye.